Good evening. This is from Kyiv headquarters, Hromadske International Sunday Show. This is the only prime time TV program explaining Eastern European geopolitical storm in English, and I am Natalia Humanyuk.
And I'm Andrei Kulikov. Tonight on the Sunday Show, we look at the peace process, at the Normandy talks with the Ukrainian and Russian leaders who haven't met for more than a year. We also present you interviews with members of the trilateral contact group. We have an exclusive report from Ukraine's Eastern Front Line. And also we'll have a look at what happens to Ukraine's stolen assets.
And you now can download our podcast on Mixcloud if you want an audio-only version of the show. You can see full version of all our interviews as well, our Russian and Ukrainian language content at our webpage, hromadske.ua, and then go en.hromadske.ua for just English content. And if you want to watch it in Ukrainian, our show, a simultaneous translation is being provided from the website as well. And if you want to watch it in English, just go to en.hromadske.ua.
And we will be back in a minute. François Hollande, Angela Merkel, Petro Poroshenko and Vladimir Putin have held their first meeting in more than a year. The Russian President Vladimir Putin traveled to Germany this week for the first time since the annexation of Crimea, and in the first meeting of the Normandy four top leaders, the talks appear to have yielded a small breakthrough.
So what has been reached is still rather vague. It's more or less was a confirmation of all the previous Minsk. We can remind you, there was the meeting, the first Minsk in September 2014, later in February 2015, and the meeting was taking place a year ago. And more or less, the result of this meeting was a creating of a roadmap which combines all kind of, it unites all the three previous meetings, so it's not much new thing. It's more or less like trying to build the framework and the timeline. So the news is that there would be another meeting of the Minister for Foreign Affairs of four Normandy countries, and it should happen by the end of November. And as well, in the end, it was clarified that it's all about the election first, and later the control over the Ukrainian-Russian border. It's a few hundred kilometers, so pretty long line. And as well, we should speak about the police mission of the OSCE, which is a very unique and for many people confusing thing. That probably could be considered a bit of the breakthrough, but we have to confirm that still 57 nations of OSCE countries have to vote for that during the meeting or the OSCE meeting. And it's not just that Putin and Poroshenko can agree on that. So we would like you to also go on to that. And Andrei, is that I think like we have to mention that there are a number of publications, so the media don't consider this as an example of the some of the media as of the tentative progress in the talk. So there was consideration that it's kind of a stalemate in the Donbas, and there is still there is pretty many people are dying, both in terms of there are dead soldiers and the locals who are affected.
Our correspondent traveled to the two closest towns, the two towns closest to the front line in Luhansk region in Ukraine, and here's the front line report for you.
Why should the Ukrainian armed forces withdraw? It's the other guys, the Russian-backed insurgent forces, who've seized our territory. They should withdraw. We support the armed forces and Ukraine. They all promise us that everything will be good. Don't worry, it's all fine. I've personally heard Stepan Polterak, Ukraine's Minister of Defense, say, don't worry, our forces will arrive there in 15 minutes, but the other side can capture everything in that time, can't they? Do you think they're going to be sitting around and waiting for our guys to come in 15 minutes? I don't understand their logic.
The people are worried about the Minsk agreements regarding their town, Stanitsa Luhanska. It's obvious what they're worried about. Most of the displaced people which have left the Luhansk territory understand that there is a danger when they enter the so-called gray zone. They are scared of losing the roof over their heads for the second time in a row, as well as food and other resources. In this sense, they're the first ones to panic.
Nighttime shelling has been registered in Stanitsa Luhanska. There's been talk that grenade launchers were fired and even two 82mm caliber shells have hit government-controlled territory. But the monitoring OC mission has just arrived and they're examining the area with help from our troops.
The shelling is mostly done during the night, from the side which is under the control of the so-called LPR. We will remain here as a part of a policing mission. Our unit, Luhansk 1, has not been ordered to withdraw, even from the gray zone. We are located in the farthest positions on the front line. The distance between us and the Russian-backed separatist forces is an estimated 2 kilometers. Whether we open the border control point depends on the Russian-backed separatist forces.
Behind that Ukrainian flag is the start of the so-called gray zone. In that area, there are no armed personnel from either side of the conflict. That's the demilitarized zone, which spans some 2 kilometers. When they were withdrawing the troops, none of the small nearby villages were placed in the gray zone. However, this did not stop the Russian-backed separatist forces from shelling the nearby villages, including Zolotay 4 and Katerinivka, which is on the other side.
The shelling which is happening in the village of Zolotay is a reason for the Ukrainian side to say, wait a minute, if we were not able to establish a complete ceasefire in this region, which was considered to be non-problematic, how can we continue to pull back weapons in other regions?
The people on that other side, just so you understand, are quite open about capturing Stanitsa Luhanska. They talk about this openly. Now, I'm not a coward and I'm not afraid, but I will only live in the area where there are Ukrainian troops.
So when we speak about Minsk, especially for the international audience, there is very often a lot of confusion. So we would like you to remind where there is the occupied territories of the Ukrainian Donbas. And you see, the whole issue of the Minsk process is about, at least at this stage, about control over this long border between Ukraine and Russia, which is currently controlled by Russia. So there is not even access of the OSCE mission there. There is no full access. And the big issue is about the election. Could the independent election held, which is the start of the any kind of process there, if there is still, Ukrainian journalists or international journalists there, if there is no still the kind of we would have the proper election, as we would say, which could be, and that is a big, more or less, discussion about that, which caused somehow a stalemate for all this time.
But the stalemate is bound to end, possibly. Olga Aivasovska, a representative of Ukraine in the political subgroup of the Trilateral Contact Group in Minsk, says that the OSCE police mission on Ukraine's eastern territories will ensure security during the elections and the following transition, so-called transition period. However, instead of retelling you what Olga said, let's see an interview with her.
Thank you very much for joining us. The Ukrainian foreign minister, Pavlo Klimkin, on Friday, he said that there's no change to the Minsk agreement, but there are some confusions about this message. Has anything changed in this agreement, the Minsk agreement, or is this actually a different strategy now to the one that was agreed in February 2015?
No, I don't think that something was changed in Berlin after Normandy format meeting in Minsk agreement, because it couldn't happen anywhere. If you are talking about border and control, I think that we are going to have transition period when OSCE mission, special, not monitoring, but police mission, armed police mission, will get this control and will give it to Ukrainian side after election day on the next day. So it's only a type of decision when we are talking about transition period. Nothing new, because according to Minsk agreement, we are going to have border control on the next day after election day. We must know and must understand that this control can be in the Russian side during political transition period, during electoral campaign, and so on and so forth.
I see. And the OSCE, have they voiced their support for such a mission?
I think it's more than less realistic, because through the 57 governors or representatives from different international groups, or we are talking about officials, ambassadors from each side, from 57 states, through them there are many our good friends and advocates, if you're talking about the USA or Canada, or our neighbors from Poland, and so on and so forth. There is no right to ban this decision from Russian side, as there are in UN Security Council. That's why it more than less can happen in future.
Yeah.
But this process of preparing special mandate or protocols and decision will be very difficult, and we can talk about months and months.
Okay, so it's a long-term strategy. Now, the first Minsk agreement was signed a long time ago now, over a year and a half ago. So why is it taking so long for this to happen? For these local elections in the Donbass to be sorted out? Like, what is the point that people disagree on exactly in the talks that you attend?
I think it's not important about election on this step, because we didn't have enough time for ceasefire, and we have many fights between different sides near the border, and so on and so forth. That's why it's not a period to talk directly and with many lines about electoral process.
But it will happen eventually, though, no?
So what?
Because it means you must have a plan, surely, for what will happen.
Of course, we have a plan.
Yeah.
And we have our Ukrainian position.
So what's the Ukrainian position, then?
If you're talking about what?
About local elections. Like, what's your strategy?
If you're talking about election, it's a proportional system. First of all, it's when all political parties can prepare their candidates and register them. So this electoral process will start from activity from each of political Ukrainian parties who will want to be on the process. It's about media, and not only about except for journalists. It's about broadcasting on that territory, because without that, none of voters can have except different resource of information, and so on and so forth.
But
IDPs. It's about IDPs, because it's very important to have these voters who left their homes on that territory on this electoral process. And even if they are living in Kiev or Lviv or Kharkiv, they must have this right to vote on their territories when they are now living.
So obviously you've done a lot of work in terms of these possible future elections. What makes you optimistic that the Russian side will agree to what you are proposing?
I'm not curious about Russian side. And if you're talking about some discussion during or through peaceful process and some good practices, we must have some points. First of all, it's time, it's talk, it's truth, and it's trust.
Okay.
We have enough time to talk about that in future because we don't have a big war activity from each of the sides. We have talks in Minsk on Normandy format and so on and so forth, but we don't have trust and truth. So we are going to have good results from Ukrainian side, but we are sure that we will need enough time for that.
I just have one very short last question. Do you see that these occupational forces will also put forward their candidates in the occupied parts of Donbass now?
It depends on electoral law. So it depends on the period of amnesty, and it depends on law base for amnesty too. So if you are talking about terrorists, I'm not sure that they will have opportunity to be a part of this electoral process.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much.
This interview, which Tom Böll took of Olga Aivasovska, is already online. You can plug it if you want, as many other detailed pieces looking at what's happening in eastern Ukraine now.
But as we know, to explain you again, that this program is made for that, the Minsk is not about the meeting of the politician, it's about how it affects the people. Till now, since from this map, which is prepared by the Institute of World Policy based in Kyiv, you can see that up to 10,000 people have been killed within the period from mid-April 2014 to this time, and a lot of them already after the Minsk Accord were enforced. We're speaking about the 44,000 square kilometers, which is the size of the territory of the Netherlands or Switzerland, are not controlled by the Ukrainian states, and the length of this demarcation line can equal to three Berlin walls. So that's kind of, this comparison could tell you more.
And 1,700,000 Ukrainians are now internally displaced persons in their own country.
So this is a long process, which would be, of course, dealt with different foreign leaders, and Germany is one of the key countries, if not the key countries today. So we still have, I think, less than we would love to have information from Berlin, whether this week meeting of Normandy Forum have taken place. And we have with us the German historian and author who is specialized on Eastern Europe and Ukraine, Jan Claas Behrends. And he had been in Berlin on the 19th of October at the time of the meeting. So that's also his photos. We're grateful he had provided to us that we can see when the German public had been meeting Vladimir Putin. What was interesting that this talk was also held together with the meeting on Syria, so there were Syrians and Ukrainians greeting Russian president in Berlin, as after the meeting in Normandy, he stayed for a longer time with François Hollande and Angela Merkel. So now two things are connected, and we know that Mr. Behrends was following and talked to a lot of high-profile officials in German capital. So Jan, thanks a lot for being with us at this time. You know, like, so what is, how this deal is seen at this point from Germany? You know, do you feel that there is any kind of a satisfaction, that there is a progress? So what should we know more?
Thank you for having me again. And indeed, it was quite interesting to be at the chancellery, at the government's office, last week when the meeting was taking place, because it was the first time, as you mentioned, that there were Syrians and Ukrainians joining each other in the protests. And I had been to many demonstrations during the Maidan when there were Poles or Georgians joining, but this was for the first time really that there were people from the Middle East and from Eastern Europe, which was quite a new situation on the protest side, on the public side of the event. On the more political side that you just mentioned, on the diplomatic side, I'm not sure I would speak about a deal. I don't think there was, you know, a real deal reached. Putin also made this very clear at his press conference at Tegel Airport when he was leaving Berlin, that he doesn't really see it as a firm commitment of Russia to anything. I think if this was about anything, then it was about keeping the fiction of Minsk alive, because Minsk here, at least by our officials, is still seen as a diplomatic success of Germany, as something that we accomplished to stop this war, or at least to put an end to the most terrible phase of this war. And the official Germany, I think, is very worried about what comes actually after Minsk. And they want to keep Minsk alive at this point. And I think that's what the meeting actually was about, more than accomplishing something of a new deal that would, you know, be there instead of Minsk.
Thank you, Mr. Behrends. What can you tell us about Mr. Putin's reaction to all those protests that were aimed at protesting the role of Russia in Ukraine and Syria? And by the way, why do you think there were no inscriptions in Russian, at least in what we have seen in your photos?
No. Well, first of all, the official Russia never comments on these demonstrations and so on. I mean, even during the time of Maidan, there were usually once a week or every 2 weeks large demonstrations in front of the Russian embassy, and the Russians have never, of course, commented on this officially. You know, they sometimes send their people to take some pictures and things like that. During the Berlin meeting last week, it was quite clear that, you know, the protest was so far away from where Putin actually was that probably he didn't even notice that there was something going on. On the other hand, there were some pro-Russian demonstrations too. I didn't take pictures of them because, you know, if you come from the Ukrainian side and you walk over to the Russian side to take pictures, it's a sort of tricky situation. I didn't want to get into any trouble. But there was much smaller Russian demonstration with some, you know, Novorossiya flags, Druzhba signs, German communist youth organizations, and so on. So you have a situation where there is a certain plurality in the protest. It wasn't all anti-Putin, but, you know, there was also these Poroshenko is a Nazi, fascist regime in Ukraine sort of demonstration, which was much smaller. The Ukrainian-Syrian demonstration, I think, was about 1,000 people, and the pro-Putin was maybe 50, 60 people.
Yeah,
many, many older comrades, I think, from East Germany.
Jan, so the couple more clarification. First of all, is there, you know, the push to have this very strict timeline for the implementation of Minsk, by the or at least like for the roadmap being developed till the end of November? And also, previous to this meeting, the whole idea is that the both sides are not committed to a fulfillment and execution of the Minsk process. That's sometimes what we hear. So is it how it's seen today from Berlin?
Well, I think the official Berlin likes to keep this distance to Russia and Ukraine and say that, you know, both sides are not committed, both sides should work on implementing Minsk. That has been the official line for pretty much the last 2 years. Now, at the same time, of course, the official Berlin knows, you know, if you talk to people behind closed doors, that first of all, Minsk is a very problematic deal for Ukraine and will probably never be implemented. And second of all, that of course this keeping equal distance to Kiev and Moscow is in a way unfair, because you keep the same distance to the aggressor and to the attacked. So I think actually what this is all about, it's more about buying time than about achieving some sort of concrete result. I think Berlin is very much interested at this point in the notion that Minsk is not dead, that there is some sort of peace process, you know, what they call a peace process going on, that we do not go back to point zero where there's nothing going on. And, you know, in order to portray that this is really the case, you know, you need to have some sort of negotiation with Putin. And obviously, at this point, Putin is also interested in creating this idea that, you know, there's something going on. I think this has less to do with Ukraine, but it had much to do with Syria, because Russia had in the last 4 or 6 weeks very, very bad press in the West, but also in Germany about Syria. We also should take a look at France. France has openly criticized Russia for war crimes in Syria. So I think from the Russian side, the idea was to get together with Merkel and Hollande in Berlin at this point to show also some sort of restraint in Syria and the whole Syrian issue, and the connection between the Ukrainian and the Syrian issue is really what is new about this conference, I think.
Jan,
you know,
so
you cannot talk about the two things separately anymore.
Jan, so thanks a lot for that insight. And we have another point of view, I won't say much different, from Germany. Hromadske also sat down with the head of the Böll Foundation, and this is Ralf Fücks, who had been in Ukraine, and more or less openly said that, as he thinks, Russia isn't perceived as an aggressor, but rather as a peacemaker in this process, which he doesn't consider to be justified.
Hello, Mr. Fuchs. We're happy you're with us today.
Glad to be here.
My first question. You're the president of Heinrich Böll Foundation. It's a political think tank that promotes the development of democratic civil society worldwide. Could you please tell us more about your efforts and especially your work in Ukraine?
The Böll Foundation is one of the German political foundations affiliated to the Green Party in Germany, but we are independent in our program making. We are funded by government, it's public money, but we are not a government agency. So we understand ourselves as part of the civil society worldwide. We are very much in favor of democracy building in the former Soviet republics, now independent states. And we had been very sympathetic to the Maidan in Ukraine, the first one, and now the last one too. We are running an office here since 6 years with three major programs. First, ecological modernization, especially energy transition in Ukraine. As you may know, Germany has quite some experience in changing our energy system, moving to renewable energies, phasing out nuclear and now also coal. We would like to support the modernization of the energy sector in Ukraine. The civil society in Ukraine is much more advanced than the political system. Most of the political parties still are, I would say, kind of old-fashioned. They still have the habits and the political culture of the past. And the parliament is not, I would say, working like a modern democratic parliament with controlling the government and discussing political alternatives and kind of transparency in policy making. We of course are aware that there's a lot of corruption still going around, and there's this kind of alliance between big business and big politics. So there are, I would say, a lot of remains of the old post-Soviet system. And at the same time, there is a very vivid civil society as far as we see it.
In April, you authored an article in which you criticized the Minsk agreements. Now we see that Minsk agreement doesn't really work, despite the efforts of Germany's foreign minister, Frank-Walter Steinmeier. What alternatives do you see to the Minsk process and how it can be changed or made to work?
Yeah, so for us, it's the wrong approach to start with autonomy for the Donbas and to start with regional elections in the Donbas. It's the other way around. First, there should be, of course, a lasting and a sustainable ceasefire. The withdrawal of Russian troops and weapons from the Donbas region. And then the establishment of, I would say, a transition administration under international monitoring, which could provide free and fair elections, including pluralism of media and then freedom of speech and all the ingredients you need for democratic elections. We are trying to convince the political then public in Germany that we need a kind of clarification of then what is Minsk about and how could it be implemented. We are rejecting the idea that, and of course, I see that the Ukraine cannot then offer a kind of Russian protectorate in the Donbas. We have to stick to the political sovereignty and territorial integrity of then Ukraine. And I'm convinced that there will be no political settlement, no political solution until the Kremlin is ready to recognize the independence of Ukraine and to understand that Ukraine will not return to the Russian world, which is obviously the goal of Putin.
Thank you. Thank you for your expert advice.
So there are so many people dissatisfied with Minsk and say it's not really workable, but can it be just annulled? That's not exactly the case. That's what we ask, because it had been voted by the UN Security Council. So in order another agreement to be working, or the Security Council should approve something else. So that's what an answer we... Until then, the Minsk Agreement has its supremacy.
And we went for the explanation to Mykola Gnatovskyy, one of the best-known Ukrainian experts in humanitarian international law. And he now chairs the Council of the European Committee to Prevent Torture.
So we just would like to clarify at this stage, it's already like the third year after the first Minsk agreement, and there are a lot of talks of, you know, talking about this document as unconstitutional. But if you just look at the point from the point of view of the law, of the international law, of the Ukrainian law, how we can approach the Minsk agreement and everything discussed within the framework in Normandy Forum?
Well, the key aspect, if we are trying to assess the Minsk II agreements from the point of view of international law, is that the Minsk II agreement has been endorsed by the Security Council of the United Nations in its resolution. So basically, the package of measures, which is part and parcel of the Minsk agreement, it is a part, also an annex to the United Nations Security Council resolution dealing with the situation in Ukraine. And that means that these measures are legally binding on all the parties, on all states which somehow play a role in this situation. It is binding on Ukraine, but it's also binding on any other state which takes part in the situation. Of course, it is binding on Russia, it is binding on any other intervening state.
The second question is about the MH17 investigation. So really, at this stage, with the new report, where we are and what could be done? I mean, we talked last year that we would wait for another investigation at this point with the information given.
Well, the main message from this report is that the investigation is ongoing. It has not stalled. The investigation is progressing. The investigation has reached some new conclusions. However, when it comes to individual criminal responsibility of persons who are responsible for this, when it comes to international legal responsibility of a state which is responsible for that as a matter of public international law, so far there has been no progress, of course. The options are still on the table. Of course, the option of a Security Council resolution establishing an ad hoc tribunal is highly unlikely to happen, because it is clear that for the time being the position of one of the permanent members, namely the Russian Federation, is that any such resolution is going to be vetoed. There are possibilities for national prosecution in Ukraine, in the Netherlands, in Malaysia, whatever. That's also on the table. Finally, it is not excluded that the International Criminal Court might take up this situation as long as it has jurisdiction for all events in the territory of Ukraine since February 2014 when it comes to the armed conflict in the territory of Ukraine. But that would be possible only on the condition that the Office of the Prosecutor of the International Criminal Court establishes that a crime falling under the jurisdiction of the court has been committed, that is, a war crime or a crime against humanity. It is not impossible. However, it is quite complicated. There might be some sort of a hybrid solution. For example, a national trial, let's say under the Dutch laws, but then it should be supported by some sort of an international resolution, ideally, again, the Security Council resolution, well, resembling something, somewhat resembling the Lockerbie trial, for example. And in such case, that might lead to a result. I'm sure that there will be some sort of a result, but it may take years.
And regarding in general the conflict between Russia and Ukraine, the third year of the conflict is exactly the time when things which hadn't been talked through earlier are coming up, with all the, you know, crimes, maybe even crimes against humanity or any kind of crimes which are related to the conflict. So far, there were reports on, we know a lot on the issues which are happening on the uncontrolled territories, but there are the questions about the secret prisons or about the, you know, other things, you know, which sometimes committed by the Ukrainian side. So how do you look at all that from the point of view somebody who really deals with the issue, with the tortures, with the imprisonment, you know, like where we are, how we can assess in general with what, like the state of affairs in Ukraine regarding the breach of the humanitarian law during the time of the conflict, in this conflict?
Well, the situation is extremely complicated. When it comes to the implementation of international humanitarian law and human rights, it poses particular challenges for Ukraine, challenges that sometimes one can say that Ukraine, it hadn't been really prepared to. Huh? So in that respect, it is not unlikely that violations of international humanitarian law and human rights have been committed on the part of the Ukrainian state, Ukrainian forces, not only on the or by the opposing party. However, it is very early to say anything definite, because there should be more looking into that. And in my opinion, it should all start at home. It should all start with a proper, effective investigation of any such allegations, of any allegations of ill-treatment, any allegations of torture, any allegations of arbitrary killings and so forth, which are brought forward against Ukraine. Those should be investigated in the first place domestically, in accordance with the criteria established by the European Court of Human Rights.
So it's still not very easy to assess how much money had been stolen by the former Ukrainian president Viktor Yanukovych
Now, a rough estimate places the sum at approximately $30 billion US dollars, according to Alan Riley from the Atlantic Council. And by the way, this does not include all the forms of property or state assets.
Recovering and managing some of these stolen assets is a difficult task, and over the past few years, Ukraine's approach on this matter had been deemed at times unsatisfactory and sometimes not very much effective. In our report, we are going to examine some of the arrested opulent properties of Yanukovych-era cronies. So take a look. This is the... we would like also to go to... that is our Reform Watch program.
In Ukraine, every time police officers arrest corrupt officials, we see how millions of dollars worth of goods are confiscated. But what happens to the money and the goods afterwards? This is one of the most famous cases of confiscated goods, the house of Ukraine's former general prosecutor, Viktor Pshonka. We're going to see what it looks like now and try to understand how the system of confiscated goods works. Vitaly Kasko, a former deputy general prosecutor, will be explaining some of the ins and outs of the system.
Why is the current system, which confiscates stolen goods, completely incompetent? Right now, we're seeing what happens to an arrested property when it comes under the control of the current system. We can only imagine how much funds will go into restoring this property. From another point of view, this property demonstrates the level of corruption inside the government during the ruling of former Ukrainian president Viktor Yanukovych. There shouldn't be a situation when anyone can enter an arrested property and take whatever they want. This is the problem. This building is not being kept secure. The most of what was inside has been stolen. So anything that the Ukrainian people could have received as a result of a court order is now in the hands of whoever got to the house of Viktor Pshonka first. If it was in its original state, not necessarily the same interior, it could have been sold off. The house itself could have been rented out. The government would have taken care of it and received at least $2,000 a month into its budget from renting out. Right now, when they arrest the property of a corrupt individual, it basically ends up in the hands of an investigator and a judge. In most cases, it either disappears or ends up in the hands of the original owner or of their affiliate. Now we've just passed a bill which will create a government entity which will be responsible for recovering and keeping all of the arrested assets. This is a good initiative because there will be someone responsible for the assets. Like, for example, right now, I still don't know who is in charge of Mezhikhirye, the massive property belonging to former Ukrainian president Viktor Yanukovych. And nobody knows, honestly, nobody knows who it belongs to now. At this stage, for the third year in a row, thanks to the self-organized civil society, this place is being preserved without any agency and without the state interfering. It's just that when people want to do something good, they organize themselves and they simply do it. But if people want to steal, no matter what you do, even if you create agencies, they will steal. So currently, around 1.5 million hryvnias, around $60,000, are spent for the upkeep of Mezhikhirye. So the following 5 points of consumption include 1 million hryvnias, nearly $40,000 for salaries, 150,000 hryvnias, nearly $6,000 to feed the staff. Diesel fuel and gasoline costs 150,000 hryvnias, about $6,000. Zoo upkeep, 150,000 hryvnias, around $6,000 again, and around 100,000 hryvnias, which is equivalent to $4,000 now, for vet services. But to be honest, we need more funds, but we don't know where to get them from. We do get donations from some of the food joints operating here, and that's pretty much it. And why should we worry about anything? Please understand me correctly. Why should we be worried about the tax service coming for us? Should we be worried about how we've managed to save property worth hundreds of thousands of dollars? We've done a number of things for the country, and we should be worried about the tax service? This is not how things work. I don't have a salary. I've been a volunteer for 2.5 years.
It's estimated that France's shadow economy is worth 1.2 trillion euros. 500 billion euros comes from illegal drug trade. For over 10 years, a law enforcement division has been operating in France, which investigates criminal offenses in the financial sector. There's also an agency which manages and recovers arrested and stolen assets. It's a fairly new organization. It was established nearly 5 years ago, and it's currently under the control of two ministries. The agency employs financiers, detectives, and lawyers. Its main task is to manage effectively the arrested assets during the pre-trial investigation. Officially, everything on the property of Mejahiria has been arrested, but what has actually happened is that a civil society organization has turned the whole property into a massive tourist destination. It's estimated that over a weekend, at least 50,000 people visit the property.
And for those of us who prefer to see rather than hear, we present a graphic look at how much money civil society organizations are spending on the upkeep of Mezhegorye. It's 1.5 million Ukrainian hryvnias a month, which roughly equals $60,000 to $65,000, of which salaries for staff are $40,000. Lunch for staff is, for some reason, excluded from this sum, $6,000. Fuel for transportation, $6,000 a month. Veterinary services, $4,000 a month. And why do they need it? Because there's a zoo, the upkeep of which is corresponding to $6,000 per month. How much progress was made by Ukrainian state authorities, you may ask, in recovering the assets stolen or allegedly stolen from the state, seems very, very little. In spite of massive pressure from the civil society to high-level officials who have been arrested for corruption, the Ukrainian state budget received around $4,000 worth in proceeds from returned stolen assets in 2016.
Hromadske international journalist Tamara Rozovan had spoken to the head of Anti-Corruption Action Center, Daria Kaleniuk, who is spearheading the process of the effective management of these types of assets. So take a look.
Hello, you are watching Hromadske International. Right now, we're going to be speaking to Daria Kaleniuk. She is spearheading Ukraine's Center for Fighting Corruption. Daria?
Hello.
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Good. Now, we're going to be talking about how Ukraine has been dealing with frozen assets which during pre-trial investigation, as well as managing some of these arrested assets. Now, we've seen what happened to Yanukovych-era official, Viktor Pshonkin's residence. It's basically been ransacked and parts of it were stolen. Now, in August, Yegor Sobolev, head of the Parliamentary Committee on Fighting Corruption, he said that most of these assets or arrested properties of corrupt officials, they end up in the hands of investigators or judges, and essentially, or eventually, they end up in the hands of the original owners of these corrupt officials because there's no effective government body managing this. Now, has there been a government body created to manage and take responsibility for some of these arrested assets?
Well, there is a law on Asset Recovery Office, which is mandated to manage seized and confiscated assets. And this body is not created yet. It's now pending the process of selection of its first head. I'm, by the way, is a member of the selection commission. And after the head will be selected, the agency will be able take over some assets for the management. And so far, Igor Sobolev was absolutely correct. Assets which are seized in Ukraine, and there is a decision on these assets that owner cannot can't possess them. These assets are being managed by investigators, prosecutors, and by their decision. So they can decide to give these assets to third parties, and the process for such decision making is very non-transparent. There is no statistic at all what's happening with these assets, whether they are their price is changing or increasing or decreasing. So I hope that with the new agency, the system will be significantly improved.
Now, how do you ensure that the accused and their affiliates don't get their hands on these properties again?
Well, first of all, the answer is very simple. There has to be proper investigation of these guys. And unfortunately, what we are witnessing with asset seizure is a result of a very unprofessional and, I would say, very biased investigation conducted by Prosecution General Office. They spent 2 years investigating cases of Yanukovych and his associates of economic crimes of these guys, simply doing nothing, but even more, even working hard to destroy the cases. And sometimes when the Prosecutor General Office received information from foreign partners on asset seizure and on some evidence of corruption kept abroad, Prosecutor General Office would use this information simply to help unseize assets abroad. And this is very unsatisfactory, of course, and the key reason why Ukraine is losing these seized assets and why owners of these assets later on receive them back. By the way, I'm very interested now in one case which is important for us because it was under a few criminal proceedings. And I'm talking about oil and gas refinery in Kherson. This is a factory which was sold in 2013, in December 2013, from Zlochevsky to Kurchenko. Zlochevsky is a former minister of environment of Ukraine, and Kurchenko was a 27-year-old oligarch, a frontman for Yanukovych. The process of this transaction ended up in Great Britain. And in early 2014, $23 million were seized by British Serious Fraud Office.
So they basically arrested these assets. So essentially, how do you find out how to trust these investigators who are in charge of investigating these cases? How do you go about picking or choosing these people who are investigating such cases?
Well, unfortunately, I'm not a prosecutor general, and I cannot choose investigators and prosecutors whom we can trust such kind of important cases. And all three prosecutor generals which we had previously and which were in charge of these cases, they failed to gather very good, trustworthy investigators, and they failed merely to give them green light to do proper work. So lots of time was lost simply to gather evidence from the early beginning. And now when society is expecting the results, PGO, Prosecutor General Office, simply say, okay, we don't have evidence. Okay, Latvia confiscated a couple dozens of millions of Arbuzov assets. But Latvia confiscated it to their budget, but not to Ukrainian budget, simply because Ukraine didn't provide evidence that these funds were stolen. The only way to ensure that investigators and prosecutors are trustworthy and are really willing to investigate and prosecute and recover assets is to change the management of traditional law enforcement agencies in Ukraine. And first of all, I'm talking about the Prosecutor General Office.
So we can follow and encourage you to follow the work of such professionals as Daria Kaleniuk and the other team, which are really digging into the investigation of the corruption from on behalf of the civil society in Ukraine, and not just that. But it's what very interesting time we experience that anti-corruption fight is often misused by some of the populist politicians and even the authoritarian regimes to, you know, boast as if they are fighting corruption while so. As it becomes so popular, and it also the issue that it's very, very hard to proceed with the reforms and to build something if there is this distrust and society believes that everybody is corrupt. About that, we talked to the extremely bright mind, a famous intellectual, Bulgarian intellectual, Ivan Krastev, who is an author of the number of books like Democracy Disrupted, and for a number of years is more than anybody else is looking at this issue. So please, your attention.
You also studied the issue of corruption, and here in Ukraine is a very hot issue, maybe the biggest one. But at the same time, we see that corruption is a global problem, and many corrupt Ukrainians, use the opportunities provided by Western schemes like offshores and others. What do you think?
As you know, my study of corruption was a particular one. I didn't like corruption, but I always had a kind of a bad taste about obsession with anti-corruption campaigns, because I do believe that paradoxically anti-corruption campaigns can be used as an instrument for justifying non-democratic regimes too. So what is happening is, first of all, you have different types of corruptions. I also very much agree it's a global phenomenon. It is very much based on the fact that some of the major motivation of people to stay clean are not there. We try to believe that if we're going to change a law, this by itself is going to change the situation, but it's very much how people feel about it. And also corruption changed its nature because of the nature of the economic regimes. In the 1970s, for example, some of the major multinational companies were very corruption-friendly, because then you have a protectionist regimes. And the only way, basically, to enter foreign markets was through corruption. When now you have a free trade, many of the multinationals perceive corruption as a hidden form of protectionism. Because when it comes to corruption, it's not the biggest bribe that wins. You should have trust. Basically, I can be ready to take your money because I know you, and I'm not going to take money from somebody else, particularly foreigner, if I don't know him. So as a result of it, you have in places in the world this basically middleman culture, which is appearance, and this type of a middleman, which are basically connecting one corrupt networks with another, is becoming very powerful. You remember Nokia's talk. Nokia connects people. Unfortunately, corruption connects people too. And quite often it connects bad people.
How the world can overcome it? How the world can overcome this network of corruption opportunities?
Listen, I do believe that the most important is that you cannot basically, and you cannot change corruption simply from above. There should be a moment in which, and you can see this in different places, when society decides that it's too much. Because only pressure from below can change corruptions, because only the fact that people living around you are not going to allow you to act like this can change the situation. Because one of the important things is that everybody knows the scale of corruption. We all know the corrupt people. But we are very much justifying that, because we say this is the game. And while this atmosphere is prevailing, nevertheless of what kind of legislation is coming, and nevertheless that probably some people are going to replace other people, this is not going to affect it. So from paradoxically, the kind of a demoralization of society is the major ally of any corrupt regime.
How can we overcome this mistrust? Because it's something that comes from the individualism, more individualist society in today's world. How you can overcome it?
Listen, for a long time, the mistrustful citizen was one of the major objectives of a good democracy, because when people trust everything that government tells them, it ends badly. But I do believe we went on the other extreme. Today, first, people are not ready to trust anything, and which is the same thing, they're ready to trust any conspiracy theory or bullshit that they're going to hear. Part of this has to do with a major cultural change in general. Basically, we don't trust institutions anymore, because some of the major institutions that have been giving us an experience together with other people we live with, for example, the army, the school, and so on, has been very much changed. Now you're not going to see the kids of the rich people in the same school like the kids of the poor people. They don't know anything about each other. I still remember an essay being written by a student in one of the very rich American colleges was on poverty, and he has written, for the poor man, everything is poor. His car is poor, his cook is poor, and his house is poor. So from this point of view, the fact that you cannot imagine the other, that all of us are living in the ghettos of opinions, created this situation in which basically you're ready to trust everything that you're going to see on your Facebook, and you're not going to trust things that basically you should. And this is not a problem in this country or in my country, it's everywhere. It's enough to look at the American presidential elections to give the fact that we're living in an age which somebody calls a post-truth politics. But if there is no trust, there cannot be trust.
But don't you think that there is a new generation, I don't know, hipsters, something like people much more open to each other, much more ready to trust?
They're ready to trust each other. They're less ready to trust institutions. And this is the story. Basically, we are sharing much more than before. You're ready to jump on a car of somebody that you don't know. You're going to allow somebody to live in your house simply because you basically have been emailing with him. This is there. But the lack of a trust in institution is totally critical, because institutions are cultivating trust to the stranger, that somebody whom you don't know personally. And paradoxically, in this most open of the worlds in which we are living, we are basically back to what was typical for the tribal societies. Namely, we are ready to trust people that we know, and we are kind of quite suspicious towards strangers and institutions.
This interview with Ivan Krastev, an internationally famous Bulgarian intellectual, is already on Hromadske's website. And this is basically all I have to say on this Sunday show from Hromadske International. But Natalia Humanyuk has a very important information for you.
So we would like to let you know that the Hromadske International Sunday show team is heading to Latvian capital Riga, where during the next week there would be a very important Riga Security Conference, and we are happy to be the information partners of the event. And we'll talk to a lot of policymakers from the Baltics, from Eastern Europe, and from all over the world. So please watch and stay tuned.